Friends, good afternoon. We have gathered today to hear a lecture from Mr. Romy Chacko, my learned friend, but full of best of the best qualities on the topic minority rights post T.M.A. scenario. Without wasting much time, I straight away come and request Mr. Romy Chacko to kindly come and deliver his lecture, please.
Respected Secretary, Office Bearers, and my dear colleagues, it's my pleasant privilege to be given this opportunity to speak to you on a topic of national importance. Well, I'll just tell you how I would like to deal with this subject. I will first deal with the circumstances which led to T.M.A. what was actually decided in T.M.A. and what is the present scenario after T.M.A. Article 30, as you all know, provides that religious and linguistic minorities shall have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. Well, we must see the historical reasons for enactment of Article 30. As you are aware, Constitution was framed in the wake of partition riots. There was a feeling of insecurity in the minds of the minorities, particularly religious minorities. So they demanded separate electorate, which was rejected by the constitution makers. And instead, they were given the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. So this is the historical context in which Article 30 had actually come, which we have to bear in mind. And it was very clear, constitution makers were very clear, it should not be subject to any restrictions unlike other fundamental rights. That is why we don't find any word of restriction in Article 30 unlike Article 19, 15, 25, 26, etc. Now, as you all know, whatever right which is given under the Constitution, even if it is not, this restriction is not specifically provided, nobody can claim a right in such a way that they can't say we are above law. So therefore, Supreme Court had to step in and regulate this right in the interest of the minority community, not in the interest of the public. That is more important. Well, the objective of Article 30, as I could gather from St. Xavier's case, it is stated therein that it is to prevent the majority from making a legislation which will take away their fundamental right, the minority's fundamental right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. So the purpose of Article 30 was to prevent the majority from making a legislation which would take away the right of the minorities to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. Now, during the late 80s and the early 90s, there was mushrooming growth of professional colleges, private professional colleges in the country. And admission was based on affluence and influence. Merit was not a criteria for admission. And substandard professional education institutions happened to come up in different parts of the country. It is in that context, Unnikrishnan versus state of Andhra Pradesh happened to be decided by the Supreme Court. So therefore, Supreme Court thought it is necessary that this mushrooming growth of substandard professional colleges are actually regulated. And the Supreme Court framed what is called Unnikrishnan scheme, under which 50% of the seats were called free seats and 50% of the seats were called payment seats. And admission in both the seats had to be on the basis of merit. 50% seats, payment seats, free seats, where the fee which was required to be paid was the same as that was charged in a government institution of the same type. And payment seat, a little more could be charged, but that was also decided by the state, which means all the autonomy which was vested on the institution was completely taken away. As immediately after Unnikrishnan, Unnikrishnan did not have the occasion to examine whether it will apply to minorities. But in Unnikrishnan's case, Supreme Court rejected the contention that right to establish and administer education institutions is part of 19(1)(g). That was specifically rejected. Well, Unnikrishnan's scheme was sought to be applied on minority institutions. So there was nothing in Unnikrishnan which would indicate that it was tested on the touchstone of Article 30. So that was questioned by the minorities. The matter was referred to 5 judges, and it was specifically argued that the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in St. Stephen's case had conferred freedom of admission to the minorities. The minorities had the right to decide the method and procedure of admission in their institution. Then the matter was referred to the Constitution Bench, 5 judges. 5 judges doubted the judgment in St. Stephen's. And the matter was referred to 7 judges, 9 judges, and later 11 judges, which resulted in T.M.A. It was referred to 11 judges because the law which was holding the field was rendered was in St. Xavier's, Gujarat, which was held, which was decided by a bench of 9 judges. One of the questions, key questions, which happened to be decided in T.M.A. was whether a citizen has a fundamental right under Article 19(1)(g) to set up an education institution. That was one of the key questions which was coined in T.M.A. apart from the question as to whether Unnikrishnan scheme will apply to minorities. So the judges of the Supreme Court examined Article 19(1)(g), which contains 4 expressions: trade, business, profession, and occupation. Straight away they rejected that it comes within the ambit of trade, business, or profession. So Supreme Court said it does not form right to establish an education institution under 19(1)(g) does not come under trade, business, or profession as referred to in Article 19(1)(g). But Supreme Court said it will come within the ambit of the expression occupation. So therefore, the intention of the Supreme Court was very clear. The idea was you don't have the right to freedom of trade or business in setting up an education institution, but it is part of right to occupation. So that is how an additional right was conferred under Article 19(1)(g), whereby a citizen was given the right to establish and administer education institution. Before that, only minorities had this particular right. But as you know, 19(1)(g) is subject to reasonable restriction in the interest of general public under 19(6). Now, it was contended that this Unnikrishnan scheme is counterproductive, and therefore the Supreme Court examined as to whether it satisfies the requirements of Article 19(6). 3 reasons were stated by the Supreme Court in rejecting Unnikrishnan scheme. 1, Unnikrishnan scheme led to revenue shortfall because the total fees which could be collected by the institution was not sufficient to run the institution. From both the payment seats and free seats, the total amount which they could collect was not sufficient to set up an education institution or to maintain educational institution. That was one reason. Second reason was that it violated the autonomy of the institution. The scheme violated the autonomy of the institution because the institution was not having the freedom of admission or the freedom to fix the fees. So it violated the autonomy of the institution. Third thing which was stated by the Supreme Court in rejecting Unnikrishnan scheme was that it resulted in cross-subsidy because one set of students had to pay the brunt of the rest of the 50%. Say, for example, those who were admitted under the payment seat quota had to bear the brunt of those who were admitted in the free ship quota or the free seats. So on all this, the 3 grounds, Supreme Court rejected this Unnikrishnan scheme. Supreme Court also said it is not a reasonable restriction under 19(6), and therefore Unnikrishnan scheme was actually rejected. Then Pai examined what are the contours of the right to administer. Supreme Court said 5 rights. Right to administer includes the right to admit a student. 2nd is the right to appoint the staff. 3rd is the right to take disciplinary action. 4th, the right to constitute a governing body. 5th, the right to set up a fee structure, reasonable fee structure. These are the 5 rights which were declared as part of right to administer under Article 30 as well as 19(1)(g). Now, all the 5 rights, Supreme Court has put some restrictions. Supreme Court drew a distinction between schools up to undergraduate level and higher education institutions. As well as Supreme Court said, there is no scope for merit-based selection up to undergraduate level. So the institution is free to choose any admission procedure which is transparent. It should be transparent. But as far as higher education institutions are concerned, court said admission has to be on the basis of merit. So a distinction was drawn with respect to admission to schools as well as higher education institutions in saying that there is no scope for merit insofar as schools are concerned, but as far as admission to higher education institutions are concerned or professional colleges are concerned, it has to be on the basis of merit. Second thing, right to appoint the staff. Yes, it is subject to the restriction that the candidate has to fulfill the qualification laid by the state. So no minority can say they don't bother about the qualification, they can appoint it. They can choose anybody, but subject to the qualification laid down by the state. Third is right to take disciplinary action. That also, minorities does not have the right to resort to naked hire and fire rule. They can take disciplinary action subject to the condition that they comply with the principles of natural justice. So principles of natural justice is one of the restrictions on your right to take a disciplinary action. Fourth is right to establish a right to constitute a governing body. Insofar as constitution of the governing body is concerned, the right given to minorities is absolute. There is no restriction which can be imposed by the state. And in St. Xavier's, this was gone into in detail. In St. Xavier's, one of the clauses which was the subject matter of challenge was the power given to the vice chancellor under the Gujarat University Act to induct nominees in the governing body of the colleges affiliated to the university. That was struck down by the Supreme Court. These are the words of Justice A.N. Ray. The impugned provision was described in these words by Justice A.N. Ray. The calm waters of the institution is not only mixed, but also polluted. This is what the Supreme Court held in 1973 in St. Xavier's case with respect to the provision which provided power on the Vice Chancellor to nominate his nominees in the governing body of a minority institution. Now, the last is the right to fix the fee. As I said, right under 19(1)(g) was traced to a right to occupation. So the object of setting up an education institution is to do charity and not to engage in profiteering. So therefore, in order to check that particular power, they said your right is only to fix reasonable fee. You can't charge capitation fee. So capitation fee is something which is not permitted. Right to fix the fee is subject to the condition that you can't charge capitation fee. So these are the five rights which are referred to in para 50 of T.M.A. Pi and the restrictions. Now, immediately after Pi, certain doubts were raised with regard to the issue with regard to the state regulation on aid at minority institutions, because Supreme Court said that aided minority institutions are subject to a greater control by the state because of the operation of Article 29.2. 29.2 says, no citizen shall be denied admission into any education institution maintained by the state or receiving aid out of state funds on grounds solely of religion, race, caste, language, or any of them. So 29.2, every minority institution which is receiving aid is subject to the discipline of Article 29.2, which says you can't, if you are receiving aid, then you cannot discriminate on the grounds of religion, race, caste, language, or any of them. Now, relying on 29.2, Supreme Court said, unaided minority institutions enjoy absolute autonomy, but as well as aided minority institutions are concerned, they are subjected to certain state control. Subsequently, after Pi, issue arose as to whether aided minorities still enjoy the right to select the principal or the head of the institution. There was a provision in the Kerala University Act, Section 57, which provided that principals have to be selected on the basis of, have to be promoted on the basis of merit. So the selection of the principal was based on promotion. This was challenged. So Supreme Court, the Kerala High Court, after analyzing Pi, held that aided minority institutions no longer enjoy the same right which they had before T.M.A. Pi, and said, If the institution is an aided minority, then they are bound by Section 57 of the Kerala University Act. Principal has to be selected or has to be promoted on the basis of seniority, not but principal have to be selected on the basis of seniority. So the senior most lecturer is bound to be selected as the principal. Matter was brought in appeal before Supreme Court. came up before Justice Ravindran, the bench ended by Justice Ravindran, and Supreme Court reversed the judgment of Kerala High Court and said, receipt of state aid will not annihilate minority rights. And therefore, the Supreme Court said, right to administer includes the right to select the principal or the head of the institution, and therefore, merely because the institution is receiving aid, they don't have to sacrifice their minority right under Article 30, and clearly clarified that Section 57 will not apply to minorities. And it was further held by the Supreme Court that freedom of choice of the staff is one of the essential rights conferred on minorities under Article 30. And they are free to choose anybody depending upon the outlook and philosophy of the candidate. That's an opportunity which is given to the management to choose anybody who is compatible with the objects of the institution. After this was decided in Secretary Malangara Syrian Catholic College in 2007. This has been recently also followed by two benches of the Supreme Court. In one of the benches said, selection has to be transparent. But of course, minorities are free to choose any qualified person as the head of the institution. The only restriction which can be imposed on selection is that the candidate should be qualified. He should fulfill the qualification laid down by the state, whatever it may be. Now, the other offshoot of PI was, a doubt was expressed about the right which was given to minorities and non-minorities. Because if you read PI, it gives an impression that there was an attempt to place the right coming under 19(1)(g) on par with Article 30. That is what one can gather from para 50 of T.M.A. PI. Because what was actually decided in SCBA in para 19 with regard to the rights culled out under Article 30 was bodily lifted and put in para 50 of T.M.A. PI, saying that right to accept the right to fix the fee structure. So therefore a question arose as to whether the minorities, whether the right under Article 30 stands differently from Article 19(1)(g) that was clarified in P.A. Inamdar. P.A. Inamdar specifically held that 19(1)(g) stands on a different footing from Article 30, mainly because 19(1)(g) is subject to reasonable restriction in the interest of general public under Article 3rd, under 19(6), which is not the case with minorities. As far as the minorities are concerned, the Supreme Court has laid down what is called dual test. The state regulation qua Article 30 has to be tested on what is called dual test. First, the regulation is to be reasonable. Secondly, the regulation should be in the interest of the minority community. These are the two restrictions laid down by the Supreme Court insofar as testing of a state regulation under Article 30 is concerned. So even if the restriction imposed by the state is in the interest of general public, it does not apply to minorities. It has to be tested as to whether it satisfies or fulfills the dual test laid down by the Supreme Court in T.M.A. PI in para 122, which means the regulation has to be reasonable and it should be and the regulation has to be an effective vehicle of education for the minority community. Then came the issue as to whether reservation will apply to minority institutions. Because para 68 of TMFI created a doubt, created an impression that state can impose its policy of reservation. State can appropriate certain percentage of seats from unaided institutions. So the matter was referred to a larger bench in Islamic. Islamic said, yes, state can definitely impose the policy of reservation in all unaided institutions, including minority institutions. That was again doubted, and the matter was referred to seven judges in P.A. Inamdar. In P.A. Inamdar, Supreme Court reversed Islamic and clarified para 68 and held that state cannot appropriate any seat from an unaided institution because they are not providing aid. As long as the state is not providing aid, they have no business to demand any seat from any unaided institution. So reservation was not permissible in an unaided institution. This judgment of the Supreme Court created an uproar in Parliament. Parliament stepped in and enacted 93rd Constitutional Amendment Act by way of Article 15.5. I'll just read out 15.5. 15.5 is very important because that has clearly brought out the distinction between minorities and non-minorities. This is what is stated in Article 15.5. Nothing in this article or in subclause G of clause 1 of Article 19 shall prevent the state from making any special provision by law for the advancement of any socially and educationally backward classes of citizens or for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes insofar as such provisions relate to their admission to education institutions, including private education institutions, whether aided or unaided by the state, other than the minority education institutions referred to in Clause 1 of Article 30. Therefore, the judgment in P.A. Inamdar was nullified by the Parliament by enacting Article 15.5 to the extent PA, to the extent it held that the Parliament or the state cannot appropriate any seat from any unaided institutions. But I would say Parliament has dissected P.A. Inamdar into two parts. The first part, of course, they said, yes, it is invalid. The second part was declared as valid, which means P.A. Inamdar, to the extent it provided that the state cannot impose its policy of reservation in an unaided institute, in an unaided non-minority institution, was actually nullified. And insofar as it applied to minority institutions were concerned, it was actually preserved. So 15.5 has clearly brought out the distinction between minority and non-minority institutions. Now, article after this, this was again put to test in the Challenge Against Right to Education Act. Right to Education Act was enacted by the Parliament pursuant to the power conferred on it under Article 15.5 and Article 21A. I'll read out Article 21A because Article 21A enables the state to make law to provide for free and compulsory education. By law, I'll just read out Article 21A. The state shall provide free and compulsory education to all children of the age of 6 to 14 years in such manner as the state may by law determine. So the state was given the power to provide for free and compulsory education through appropriate law. So they exercised the power and enacted Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act, in which specifically provided that 25% seats have to be reserved in all education institutions, unaided institutions, for economically weaker sections and for disadvantaged sections of the community. This was challenged before the Supreme Court by both minority and non-minority. Matter was referred to three judges headed by Justice Kapadia, and that is Society of Public Schools Rajasthan. In that particular case, Supreme Court said it will apply to all institutions except unaided minority institutions. Supreme Court said Right to Education Act, to the extent it applies to unaided minority institutions, is ultra vires both Article 30 and 15.5 of the Constitution. And it was applied to even aided minority institutions. Subsequently, the unsuccessful people again challenged the validity of Article 21A and 15.5 before the Supreme Court in what is called Pramathi Educational and Cultural Trust versus Union of India. So they contended that Article 15.5 is violative of Article 14 of the Constitution, principle of equality. They also contended that Article 15.5 violate secularism, which is a basic feature of the Constitution. That was rejected by the Supreme Court because Supreme Court said minorities constitute a separate class. So therefore, it does not violate Article 14. And preference given to minorities under Article 30 in effect gives effect to secularism. That does not actually affect secularism. It promotes secularism. Therefore, the challenge by non-minorities on the ground against the Right to Education Act, as well as Article 21A and 15.5, was rejected by the Supreme Court on the ground that it does not violate any of the basic features of the Constitution. Supreme Court went further and said Article 30, it is held in Keshavananda Bharati that Article 30 constitute a basic feature of the Constitution. And therefore, the law contemplated under Article 21A does not enable the state to override Article 30 of the Constitution. So the law which is contemplated under Article 21A has to be in consonance with Article 30, and it can't go against Article 30. And finally, Supreme Court said, Right to Education Act will not apply to any minority institution, be it unaided or aided. So Right to Education Act, in fact, the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in Pramathi declared that Right to Education Act will apply to all institutions except minority institutions, both unaided as well as aided minority institutions. So this is how Supreme Court has actually dealt with the validity of Article 21A, 15.5, and Right to Education Act. Now, questions often arise as to whether the right given to minorities is absolute. Yes, it is absolute in contrast to other fundamental rights. It is absolute in contrast to Article 19, 25, 26, 15, etc., because no restriction is actually provided in Article 30. But Minorities cannot say that they are above law. Therefore, Supreme Court said, yes, the state can impose what is called reasonable regulation on minority right in the interest of morality, health, public order, then in the interest of efficiency of administration, the state can impose what is called reasonable regulation on minority right. Let us see what constitutes this reasonable regulation on minority rights. Say, for example, right to admission. Yes, right to admission up to undergraduate level, they have full freedom to admit any student, but it has to be transparent. And beyond that, it has to be on the basis of merit. This is a reasonable regulation on minority rights. Then the next is right to appoint the staff. Yes, it is subject to reasonable regulation that the candidate should fulfill the qualification laid down by the state, because that is necessary for promoting the standard of the institution. Then the right to terminate a staff, that is also not absolute in the sense it is subject to principles of natural justice. Then as far as governing body is concerned, it is absolute, they can take anybody. Then the next is right to fix a fee structure. Yes, there also it is subject to the condition that you cannot charge what is called capitation fee. You can charge what is necessary for running the institution and a reasonable revenue surplus which is required for the purpose of development of the education institution, but you can't charge capitation fee. It is a reasonable regulation. So these are the five restrictions. These are the rights as well as the restrictions emanating out of Article 30 as well as 19(1)(g). So as on today, 19(1)(g) stands on a separate footing from Article 30, which has been clearly brought out in PA Inamdar as well as Pramathi Educational Cultural Trust. Now, there has been a recent judgment of the Supreme Court Constitution Bench in Modern Dental College. Modern Dental College, I would say, did not deal with Article 30. Modern Dental College, the state regulation was tested on the touchstone of Article 19(1)(g). The entire endeavor of the Supreme Court was to examine as to whether the state regulation, the Madhya Pradesh Act, was consistent with Article 19(1)(g). Supreme Court said, yes, it is valid because it is a reasonable restriction under 19(6). There was no occasion for the Supreme Court to examine as to whether the impugned regulation in the Modern Dental College was consistent with Article 30. There is one paragraph, which is paragraph 55, which says regulations may also apply to minority institutions in the context of T.M.A.P.I. and Inamdar. That's the only stray sentence which deals with the Article 30 of the Constitution. That does not mean that this impugned regulation referred to in Modern Dental College is consistent with Article 30. That only says what is actually decided in PI and Inamdar, I've already said. Therefore, unless and until there is a specific decision that this regulation is valid quo Article 30, we can't say that Modern Dental College applies to. I'm not going further into the matter. I'm not going into the subsequent legislations, NEET, counseling and other things, because these are all sub judice. Therefore, I would not like to go into those aspects. So these are my words. I thank the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity to speak to you. Thank you very much. If you've got any doubts, you can ask me. Thank you.
I am really thankful to my brother, Mr. Romy Chacko. They have given such a wonderful lecture. Now I request Mr. Sukuma to kindly present a bouquet to Mr. Romy Chacko. I now request Mr. Rajiv Kumar, Member Executive of Supreme Court Bar Association, to present a bouquet to Dr. John Verghese, Principal of St. Stephen's College. I now request Mr. Yogesh Sharma to present a bouquet to Mr. R. Basant, our Senior Advocate. We are thankful to him that he has come and joined us. I request Mr. Rajiv Kumar again to present a bouquet to Mr. Thomas P. Joseph, Lalit Senior Advocate. And again, I request Mr. Rajiv Kumar to present bouquet to Mr. G. Shishagiri Rao, sir. I am thankful to Mr. P.H. Parekh, our six-time president. Unfortunately, he had to go somewhere, so he has left. Mr. R. Basant, a respected senior, Mr. Thomas Joseph, Mr. Shakil Ahmed Sayed sir, Mr. Sheshagiri Rao, and my friends at the bar for joining us today and listening to our wonderful lecture from Mr. Romy Chacko. I thank you all for coming and joining us. Thank you.